السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to the 18th episode in our program Gardens of the Pious in explaining the great book of Al-Imam al-Nawawi, Riyadus-Saliheen or Gardens of the Pious. Today also be the second episode in explaining the book of As-Sab or Patience. There was an introduction last time to patience, its meaning and its different categories and its virtues. And today, inshallah, Azzajal will begin by studying the ayat which Al-Imam al-Nawawi listed in the beginning of the chapter. He listed six ayat. The first ayah is ayah number 200 of Surah Al-Imran. And by the way, that is the last ayah as well. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the believers to be patient and to be more patient than their enemies and to be patient on the battlefield. So he says, Azza wa Jalla, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sabiru wa sabiru wa rabitu wattaqu allaha la'allakum tuflihun. O you who believe, asbiru. That's a command verb which means be patient. وَصَابِرُوا be more patient than your enemies. وَرَابِطُوا المُرَابَطَة is to guard your territory by stationing army at the borders. The borders guards or control to guard the areas where the enemies may come into the Muslim state from. That is al-murabata. So it is pertaining to jihad, and al-jihad requires a great deal of patience. And in the case of border control, they sit there for days, for weeks, for months, for years. Yes, they take shifts, but they don't know at what time the enemy may attack or try to sneak into the country. So they are always on high alert. They are protecting the borders of the Muslim state. That's why they have to be there 24/7, they have to be patient, and they have to be fully awake and alert. In the first command, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Asbiru, O you who believe, Asbiru, be patient. Some of the Mufassirin said, the command of being patient, to stay away from disobedience, to abstain from anything that they may displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to avoid angering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sabiru, to be patient upon fulfilling what Allah commanded. As we mentioned before, that there are three different types of patience or levels. Sabrun an al-ma'siyah wa sabrun ala al-ta'a wa sabrun ala al-balaya. Patience which is required to endure calamities patiently. So the second is Al-Muthabara, or to be patient upon performing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. Wal-Murabata is to be persistent and continuous in fulfilling the acts of worship, the different ibadat, the different ta'at, different means of obedience, and so on. As in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in the hadith which is narrated by Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, when he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ألا أدلكم على ما يمحو الله به الخطايا ويرفع به الدرجات. Shall I not guide you to an act which if you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will erase your sins thereof and will raise your ranks because of this act of obedience They said, certainly, Ya Rasulullah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إسباغ الوضوء على المكاره وكثرة الخطى إلى المساجد وانتظار الصلاة بعد الصلاة فذلكم الرباط فذلكم الرباط. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicated there are certain acts such as perfecting your wudu even during times, sometimes it is pretty cold and you don't have warm water. Still, you have to wash all the body parts which should be washed during ablution or whenever it is required to take ghusl. Or whenever you're wearing a suit and tie and you feel like, you know, you wrinkle your shirt. No. إِسْبَاغُ الْوُضُوءِ عَلَى الْمَكَارِهِ. Perfect your wudu. كَثْرَةُ الْخُطَى إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ. Frequently going to the masjid back and forth, back and forth. Somebody will say, don't you get tired? No. As a matter of fact, I feel like I'm recharging my battery. I'm increasing my iman. I would never get tired of going to the masjid back and forth. And the third, وانتظار الصلاة بعد الصلاة. Anxiously waiting for the following prayer. You just finished the Maghrib and you are anxiously waiting for the Isha to come. You pray the Isha, you're waiting for Fajr, you pray Fajr, you're waiting for Dhuhr. It's like your entire life is revolving around the prayer. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, these practices which are all pertaining to offering as-salah, that is al-ribat. This is like the soldier, the border control, or the border guard, who is camping and waiting, expecting anything to happen. He's always on a standby position. That is a ribat. So a person who's persistent in his ibadah is a murabit. So the ayah also may mean, اصبروا وصابروا ورابطوا, pertaining الطاعة, to be patient upon offering what Allah ordered, to be continuous and persisting in offering your acts of worship, and to be patient, to abstain from what Allah has prohibited. What if you do all of that? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sabiru wa sabiru wa rabitu wattaqullaha la'allakum tuflihun. Wa sabiru wa rabitu wattaqullaha. At-taqwa is an umbrella that covers al-sabr, al-musabara, al-murabata, doing the good deeds, abstaining from what Allah has prohibited. All of that is included in at-taqwa. If you do all of the above, what will happen? If you comply with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 200, the last ayah of Surah Ali Imran, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ, in order to be successful. Al-falah, or success, is achieving all your goals. Achieving your worldly goals, the goals of the dunya, and the goals of al-akhirah. In al-akhirah, what do we desire? To skip the fire of hell? To be saved from the torment of an-nar? Not to be held accountable? And to make it safely to al-jannah? That is salvation. That is the ultimate success. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. That is the ultimate success when he said فَقَدْ فَاز. If you skip the fire and you make it safely to al-jannah. So by being sabir, wal-musabara, wal-murabata, and fulfilling taqwa Allah Azza Jal, you achieve success. في الدنيا وفي الآخرة. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the successful ones. As a matter of fact, there have been guidance in the Qur'an, in many ayat of the Qur'an, towards achieving success. For instance, in ayah number 130 of Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you avoid dealing with riba, you will be successful. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا الرِّبَا أَضْعَافًا مُضَعَافًا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. And it is a little tempting. No, it is not a little tempting. It is greatly tempting. The earning seems like it will increase. To work in a conventional bank or to deposit your money and collect that much interest every month. So you need sabr. So if you do and you be patient and you avoid disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your earning, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ, you will be among the successful ones. May Allah make us amongst them. In Surah المائدة آية number 90 when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says يا أيها الذين أمنوا إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه لعلكم تفلحون. You avoid drinking, gambling and so on in order to be successful. In Surah Al-Hajj in ayah number 77, I'm just giving you various examples. Otherwise, there are many ayat in the Quran pertaining al-falah and success. In Surah Al-Hajj in ayah number 77, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اَرْكَعُوا وَاسْجُدُوا وَاعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ وَفْعَلُوا الْخَيْرَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Offer the salah, bow down, make sujood, اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ, worship your Lord, and do good deeds in order to be successful. In Surah An-Nur, in ayah number 31, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. You want to be successful? Make tawbah. Repent unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is exempt. تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. All of you who you believe, turn unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with repentance in order to be successful. Last but not the least, in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, in ayah number 10, you remember what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَدَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. You hear the adhan, the call to the Jumu'ah prayer, abandon businesses, shut down your business, answer the call to the prayer. Then after the prayer is over, فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةُ. Once you finish the prayer, فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَبِتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Finish your prayer, spread out on earth. Seek the provision, the lawful provision. Continue working if you wish to. وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. And remember Allah much while praying, while working, while in your market, in every position, in every condition, in order to be successful. I don't want to spend much with this ayah, or otherwise we can just go on and on. Very beautiful ayah of Surah Al-Imran. Then in Surah Al-Baqarah, in ayah number 155, and that is the second ayah Al-Imam al-Nawawi listed in the beginning of the Book of Patience. This is the most famous ayah in this regard. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirmed and emphasized the fact that every human being will be tested and tried. And whether you're patient or not, that's not gonna change the fact that you will have to go through the tests and trials which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preordained for you. So if you're being patient, you're a winner. Because number one, you cannot skip the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot save yourself from anything that Allah has preordained for you, nor can you ever get anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not prescribe for you. So it is best for you to endure all of that patiently. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ.
This ayah, or these ayat actually, are the greatest reference with regards to the subject of patience. As we see in the first ayah 155, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we certainly shall try you with something of fear, of poverty, loss of wealth, poverty, of beloved ones, lives, fruits, yet give glad tidings to the patient ones. So وَلَا نَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, there has been several means of confirmation. Alwa, which is used for oath or qasam. And the lam. And then وَلَا نَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, it's all about swearing. Allah is confirming the fact that certainly we shall try you with some of fear. He did not say with fear, because if he were to cast fear upon us, we'll expire, we'll be destroyed. But something of fear. Something of fear on the battlefield, whenever we are threatened by whatever, by our enemies, by any means of the means of fear, but not all the fear. والجوع, and something of hunger as well, to see with hunger. And depression and provision, poverty, loss of beloved ones, depression in fruits and crops. If you endure all of that patiently, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, give glad tidings to the patient ones. To those who recognize the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this entire life is all about tests and trials. These are just some of the means which Allah mentioned in the ayah. So you have one of two choices. Choice number one, to recognize that مَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُخْطِئَكَ وَمَا أَخْطَأَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُصِيبَكَ, as in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Whatever befell you was never going to escape you. And whatever escaped you was never going to befall you. Everything happens due to an accurate measure, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Hakim, Al-Alim. So you keep this in mind, then whenever an affliction befalls you, you say Alhamdulillah, and you be patient. Choice number two, object, criticize, and curse, and say, no way! Okay, what's next? Okay, you lost your son. You keep screaming and jumping to the roof. What's going to happen? Is your son going to come back to life? You lost your money in the stock market. What's going to happen? You lost your business. You lost whatever. You know, those who take the second choice, basically they do as many people did in America. When they lost their money in the stock market, they took their lives. They objected to Allah's decree. And they said, no, no way, I cannot live as a poor person. I don't have to live. So they took their lives. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whosoever takes his life by any of the following means, for instance, whoever stabs himself with a knife, he will be stabbing himself in the fire of hell forever. He stabs himself, he's being tortured by enduring the pain of the stabbing. Then once he dies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will revive him again and again and again and again, eternally. A person who drinks any poisonous substance in order to take his life, he will be continuously doing so in the fire of hell. A person who jumps off a bridge or a high building or a mountain, he will be doing the same in the fire of hell forever, because you objected to Allah's decree. But look at number one. Right before the program, and I don't know, maybe it was a coincidence, but a very nice coincidence. The narrator in the filler was saying that a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, how wonderful is the affair of a believer, for those who have been waiting for the program and got to hear this filler. How wonderful is the affair of a believer. If some good happens to him, he is thankful and grateful to Allah, and that is good for him. What if some bad happens to him? He is patient, and that too is good for him. And no one behaves likewise but a true believer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, give them glad tidings. With what? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةً, those whom whenever they are afflicted with any calamity, they do what? قَالُوا, right away, they say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, we all belong to Allah and unto Him we shall return. Your son broke the most expensive dish at home. Before investigating whose fault is it, say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. You heard about an accident. You lost your car. You lost your business. You got fired. First of all, say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. I was once traveling with my sheikh. Dr. Muhammad Ismail al-Muqaddam. May Allah preserve him. And I lost my phone, or this is what I thought. And to me, it was a big thing because, you know, it has all my data. Nowadays, with the smartphones, you put your mind into rest. You rely on the phones. So I lost it. So I said to the Sheikh, wait a minute, I lost my phone. He said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Say it before any word. So I said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you say this statement, which means all of us and what we own belong to Allah and unto Him we shall return. You lost your phone. Soon you yourself are going to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. Nothing in this life is worth it. Don't be sad. Just say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Qaddar Allah wa ma sha'a fa'al. Whatever Allah decreed, He does and He fulfills, and no one can stop it. And look at the verses of saying this statement. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مَّنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Such people who endure the tests, the calamities, the masaib patiently, and they say, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَجْعُونَ, soon after they're afflicted with the calamity, such people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises them in al-mala'il a'la, among the angels. And He descends His mercy upon them. Wallahi, we find tranquility when we say this statement. No matter how severe, how big is the calamity, when you say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilahi raji'un, Allah descends tranquility over your heart because you deserve it. Wa rahmah. Hey, wait a minute. Wa ulaika humul muhtadun. And such people are the truly guided ones. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. Umm Salama radiyallahu anha, the mother of the believers, lost her husband Abu Salama, and they had a very interesting love story. And by the way, they were the first house to make hijrah, and they sacrificed everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a long story, to make it short. All of a sudden, she lost her husband. He died, Abu Salama, may Allah be pleased with him. She grieved for his death, and she felt very sad. Soon after he died, she remembered that the Prophet ﷺ said, if anyone is tested with any calamity or lost anything, and he says, Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa akhlif or wa akhluf li khayran minha, two different narrations. Allah will give him a better replacement, will give him better than what he lost. What does the dua say and mean again? Allahumma ajurni fi musibati. This is a calamity, this is a musibah. If you are being patient, there is a reward, there is an ajr. How much ajr would be discussed in the following ayah. But wait a minute. وَخْلُفْ لِي or وَأَخْلِفْ لِي خَيْرًا مِنْهَا, and give me better than what I lost. I lost my phone, Allah give me better one. When my wife had a miscarriage, and I was after waiting for so long, for many years, right away in the hospital, she reminded me to say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Allahumma ajurna fi musibatina wa akhluf lana khayran minha. A few months later, alhamdulillah, she conceived again, and now she gave birth to twins. We lost one, maybe he would be sick, maybe he would be whatever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us better, healthy two, by the grace of Allah, by the barakah of this dua. Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa akhluf li khayran minha. You know what happened? She said, and who could be better than Abu Salama? She said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. She thought about it, and give me better than what I lost. Who would be better than Abu Salama? She said, Wallahi, I've got to say what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. She said it. Allahumma ajurni fi musibati. وَخْلُفْ لِي خَيْرًا مِنْهَا. Give me better than what I lost. Soon after the iddah is over, 4 months and 10 days, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Hatib ibn Abi Balta'a to propose to Ummu Salama. Not that Hatib would marry her, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was proposing to her. Allah gave her a better replacement or not, she has become the mother of the believers. And in paradise, she would be rather the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to trust Allah. We need to love Allah. we need to be of the first category. You believe that these tests and calamities are from Allah and this is the qadr, you cannot change it, that's it, settle down. So how should we go about it? Be patient. There is a higher level to be radi, rida, to be pleased and content with Allah's decree. And the third, to be grateful. Alhamdulillah, you gave me that, you know better, that I deserve that. Maybe it is one of the means of erasing of my sins. Or perhaps to raise me in higher ranks in paradise. No problem. It is from you. You love me and I love you so much, Ya Allah. So I would accept anything that you give me. Even what appears to people as bad from you, it is definitely the best. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مَّنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. We'll continue with the ayat after the break. InshaAllah, stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول
الله حبيب الله. In a game of golf, both the caddy and the golfer have the same goal, to get the ball into the hole. Interest-free banking is similar. With a clear view of the fairway, a predefined agreement without shifting targets, things should end up where you want them. Your deposits are safe, and your funds are ethically managed with a transparent and equitable approach to sharing risk and reward. No interest burden means more time to relax, without the worry of nasty surprises. Rest assured, our interest is mutual. Jazz Bank, Nigeria's first full-fledged non-interest bank.
Life is a journey, beginning with a single step. The direction is clear. But it still needs guidance.
I stand before you with an attentive heart. Erase my sins from the present and past.
Huda GPS.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. I would like to remind you with our phone numbers, because in this segment we will be more than happy to take your phone calls. The phone numbers beginning with the area code 002-0238-555-248-249. And also the email address is gardens@huda.tv. I've got a few questions, inshallah, after a few presentation or a short presentation, inshallah, we'll tackle some of these questions, inshallah, azajal. But with the third ayah we have in the chapter of patience, ayah number 10 of Surah Az-Zumar. If you remember before the break, I said, what kind of reward? أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ أَجُرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. What kind of reward will they get? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained the kind of reward in ayah number 10 of Surah Az-Zumar, when he says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجَرَهُمْ. How much reward? بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Without limit. Without measure. An abundant reward. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-An'am by the end, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Yeah, the good deed will be rewarded for 10 times more. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He rewards up to 700 times. كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلَ فِي كُلِّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ. That's 700. وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. So a single good deed can be rewarded with 700 rewards greater than the good deed itself. 700 and even more. But in the case of patience, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not specify. Why? Because it is without limit. You will be rewarded abundantly for patience without hisab, without limit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pour reward on you and will give you hisab, will give you jaza and thawab without limit. The following ayah is ayah number 43 of Surah Ash-Shura, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ, which means, and he who shows patience, endures patience, and forgives, that is indeed from the commended matters or things by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a matter of fact, I would like to explain the word azm a little deeper. Azm means strength, shidda, and power. It is not easy when somebody addresses you with foolishness, insults you, or hits your car, or does some bad to you, to say, may Allah forgive you, and let go. No, if somebody cuts you off, you try to chase him and do the same to him. This is a human nature, right? If somebody tries to cut corner and he stands before you in the line, you let go. This is almost everybody would do the same. And if somebody were to insult you or address you with foolishness, you would reply with the same or even worse, to take revenge for yourself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ. If somebody addresses you with foolishness, if somebody oppresses you, if somebody transgresses against you, and you pardon him, and you forgive, and you show patience, that is indeed of the matters which are very strong. It requires a strong iman. It needs a strength of faith. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commanded in the Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. Be patient the same way that the prophets of al-azm, the prophets of patience, the prophets of strength of iman, they have suffered a great deal. See how much Ibrahim alayhi salam have suffered from his people. Or Musa alayhi salam, Kalimullah, how much he suffered from the Pharaoh. Or Isa alayhi salam. The prophets of Ulul Azm are Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. So this is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will be rewarded a great deal if you show patience and pardon, even though you're capable to take revenge. The brother just put the word عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ or Al-Azm of which means strength on the screen. جزاكم الله خيرا. وقال تعالى in Surah Al-Baqarah in ayah number 153. Ayah 153. That is basically the fifth ayah that Al-Imam Al-Nawawi, may Allah have mercy on him, stated in the beginning of the book of Patience. He said, استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. إِسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Allah is commanding whom? Who else other than the believers who would pray? Who else other than the believers would endure patiently all the hostile situations? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. O you who believe, seek help in patience and in the prayer. Verily Allah will be or is with the patient ones. مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. You know this ayah is ayah number 153 of Surah Al-Baqarah. Look at the following ayat. It's talking about jihad. It's talking about struggling for the sake of Allah, for His cause on the battlefield, fighting the enemies of Allah. and not to perceive that those who die for his cause as dead. No, nay, rather they are alive. That is eternal real life. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. Then it is followed by ayah 155, which began our talk with the second ayah which we discussed, that everybody shall be tested and tried, and so on. Seek help in as-salah, seek help in patience and in the prayer. How? Like, if I need to find a job, how would the prayer help me? How would patience help me? This is actually what you need. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا حزبه أمر فزع إلى الصلاة. If anything would worry the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he would rush to pray. Whether it's a fard prayer or the prayer, nafli prayer, when he enters the prayer, he finds a solution. When he resorts to Allah and he seeks shelter in Allah and he seeks his help, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would definitely help him. And similarly would help every person who's seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah. Inna Allaha ma'a as-sabirin. We know that in many ayat in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He's with us, such as وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wheresoever you are, all of you, Muslims and non-Muslims, believers and disbelievers, obedience and disobedience. Yeah, He's with us with His knowledge. He's all acquainted with what we do, right? But إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ, this is a special ma'iyah. He is with the patient ones, with His support, with His help, with His rescue. So whenever people endure things patiently, Allah delivers right away. He is with them with His help, support, and answering their dua. Now let's start taking some phone calls. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abrar from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ahlan wa sahlan, Brother Abrar, how are you?
Allah yisalmak. May Allah bless you and the whole Ummah al-Islamiyah with Jannat al-Firdaus.
Ameen, ameen. Thank you so much. Barakallah feek.
Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakallah.
Sheikh, I just had one question about the topic you're talking about. How could a person differentiate between till what stage should he do sabr? Like, for example, if somebody is transgressing against him, either in work or in traffic or wherever it might be, how could you put a limit to it? Okay, till this stage, it's sabr. But after this, he's doing dhulm on me. And, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I'm not mistaken, there's a hadith about it. Don't do dhulm. And don't be so quiet that dhulm should be done on you. So yeah. I just wanted to know that where is the limit of sabr? How could you differentiate, okay, that this is the maximum? Or does it depend on the human being?
Sure. Jazakallah khairan, Abrar. Barakallah feek. In the ayah of Surah Ash-Shura, ayah number 43, which I recited, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ, which Brother Abrar is addressing or following up on the meaning of this ayah. In the previous ayah number 42, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا السَّبِيلُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ يَظْلِمُونَ النَّاسَ وَيَبْغُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ أُولَئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. The blame is on those who oppress people. And يظلمون الناس ويبغون في الأرض بغير الحق. And they spread mischief on earth with falsehood. So they should be blamed. They are to be blamed. They should be punished. And in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القول إلا من ظلم. Allah doesn't like people to show or to reveal the evil statement or the bad statement, except if somebody has been oppressed. You have the right to present your case before the authorities. It is absolutely your right, especially for major things, theft, somebody address your honor with foolishness. You have the right to do all of that. But we're talking about things which happen on daily basis. As I mentioned, an example, somebody cut you off on the road. Okay? maybe he did it as an accident. So you have the choice of taking revenge or treating him the same. He forgot his high beam on and it's annoying you. So you can do the same to him. Or you can be patient and you can pardon and you can let go. So this reaction, even if the transgressor person who may have done it without even intention, they didn't know, not deliberately, did not know that you dealt with him likewise, your reward is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you have been oppressed, if somebody has hurt you or took any of your rights, it is absolutely your right to take it to the authorities and pursue it in a legal fashion. Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Aini, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi, Shaykh, how are you?
How are you, sister?
Wa alaikum salam, Shaykh, how are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah, barakallahu feekum.
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Shaykh, I want to ask you about niqab. I want to tell niqab.
You want to wear niqab?
I want to know the rule of niqab.
You want to wear niqab?
Yeah.
Go ahead and wear it from today, inshallah. Because the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his daughters and all the women of the companions used to wear niqab. Yes, there are two different opinions with regards to explaining the ayat. That's not the position to go through the ayat. We dealt with this in Ask Huda repeatedly. But if you're asking me, I would say go ahead and wear it, because by that you will be copying the wives and the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the women of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Barakallahu feek. Sister Zainab from the UK had sent us a question. The question is, why Muslim women have to wear the black color all the time, or recommended to use the black color? As a matter of fact, Muslim women are not recommended to wear black. In fact, if you want to wear brown, white, or red, or whatever color, as long as your aba'a, or outer garment, is covering the body properly and fulfilling the conditions of hijab, of being loose, of being opaque, not see-through, of doesn't having any source of attraction such as glitter and so on, or drawings which would attract the viewers to look at you, then any color you may wear. And that is in Hajj, in Ihram, or otherwise. Okay? Not because you see women most of the time wearing black that you have to wear black. No, you don't really have to wear black. You may wear black or any other color if you keep in mind the previous conditions which I mentioned. Brother Qasim from the UK as well. I'm very impressed because, you know, currently we're off the hot bird and the euro bird. We cannot afford to air our channel on any of these satellites currently. There has been some people, mashallah, generous people who have sponsored the channel for a few years, but unfortunately we cannot afford it anymore. But we still get calls and emails from all over the world by the grace of Allah via the live streaming. So thank you so much for those who are following us and encountering the trouble of sometimes being interrupted and so on. Brother Qasim from the UK says, what do you say when you first enter and see the Kaaba? I know that there is a very widespread statement which says that for a person who lays his or his eyes on the Kaaba for the very first time, they have a dua which will definitely be answered. And subhanAllah, I searched for this hadith or reference. There is no such reference whatsoever. It is, again, one of the things which people made up. But the good news is, while you're performing tawaf, your dua is most likely to be accepted. While looking at the Kaaba or sitting, because this is a sacred place, the Kaaba and its surrounding. وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا. This is the safest, the most secure place on earth. This is where you find tranquility and comfort for your heart the most. And this is a place where your dua is most likely to be accepted. whether it's your first time to see the Kaaba, second time, or 10 times, it doesn't matter. Okay? So, whenever you enter the haram, make dua. And during your tawaf, make dua. And during your sa'i, make your dua, supplication as well, and so on. Brother Fuad, this is a lengthy question. I don't know if we have time to answer, but I will do my best. He says, I have missed my prayer for all my life. I don't pray. And he's also calling, sending his question from the UK. He's working in a supermarket as an employee. And he even misses the Jumu'ah prayer. Okay, to make the long story short. Ya Akhi, Ya Ukhti, brothers and sisters. We live in this life for one sole purpose. وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Do we get it? Surah Al-Dhariyat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have not created the jinn and the ins, human beings, but for one reason. That is the object of our, the purpose of life. Why have we been created? The purpose of life to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He allows us to work and to earn our provision lawfully, and this is a test. When you have a chance to increase your rizq on account of skipping the prayer, that's a test. So endure it patiently. Keep your duty to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Offer the prayer on time and work as much as you can. But work in halal work. Do not sell liquor. Do not sell pork. Do not sell lotto tickets. Do not sell cigarettes. Because I know that in the supermarket you'll be doing all of that. And that hardens the heart. The bad deeds accumulate and pile up on the heart of the person until they darken the heart, they make it opaque, and the heart will be like in a shell. Does not comprehend what's good and what's bad. And it's very easy for such person to abandon the prayer. It's easy for such person to indulge into the haram, even into the major sins. It's easy. Why? Because he's so distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at that which we discussed, subhanallah, in Surah Al-Baqarah. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah. Seek help for your worldly needs and for success in the hereafter, in patience and in as-salah. So, there is no barakah for a person who does not pray. There is no blessings in his provision, in his work, in his family, in his children, in anything. So keep in mind that you have to make up the prayers that you missed. You should repent unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala soon as after you hear this statement. May Allah make it easy for you to repent. And for a condition that wheresoever you work, whenever it's Friday, have an hour to pray Jumu'ah. Or take the whole day off and work in other days. You're working in a supermarket, okay? You have a flexible schedule. And also the 5 daily prayers. If you're working in a halal field, and you have your janamaz, or you can pray anywhere, even in the parking lot, do not miss your prayer. Because the very first su'al on the Day of Judgment will be about the prayer. So if you pass this question successfully, then everything will be easy accordingly. Otherwise, the person will be in trouble. As far as how to make up the missed prayers, there are two opinions. One which is to pray every day as much prayers in order as you can, estimating how many years that you skipped the prayer. Or there is another opinion which says that the person who did not pray at all for years have actually abandoned the deen. So when he repents, he starts from the scratch. And at that, he should increase praying nawafil along with sincere tawbah. Brothers and sisters, by that we come to the end of today's episode of Gardens of the Pious. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst its dwellers. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. And until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best
is best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.